Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Palm Sunday worship. Who would have thought we would have Palm Sunday in a video fashion, but here we are. It's so strange, and yet is still a great day for us to celebrate and to remember our King, Jesus, as he makes his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Before we begin our worship, I want to just give a few announcements to begin. Want to just say, if you haven't already been to our cathedral website, want to encourage you to go there, your-cathedral.org, your-cathedral.org, and on that you'll see right at the top of the homepage, you'll see how we as the cathedral are helping and working in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic. So if you go there, you'll find there's a few buttons at the top that help us as you want to join us for evening prayer. There's a button for that. If you want to join us for worship, there's a button for that. If you want to get connected as a part of one of our shepherding groups, there's a button for that. And if you want to offer care or receive care, there's a button for that. And then there's going to be a new button starting today, and that will be a give button. And let me just tell you about what we're doing right now. We've got two things that are important for you to understand. One is that as we go forward, our expenses as the church, for the most part, stay the same. We are, as a result of this staying at home order, some of our expenses have changed and are less. But we want to reappropriate some of those funds to help care for those who are in need. In addition to that, we also have created a new fund called the Cathedral Community Care Fund. And this is a fund specifically set apart to help people who have financial needs as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. People who have lost their jobs, people who are underemployed, perhaps have lost one of a few of the jobs that they may have been doing. And so we have this fund that has been created, it is ready to go, and we need you to give to that if you feel so called. And in that give button, there's a way to link straight to giving to our general fund. There's a link to give to the Cathedral Community Care Fund, or C3 Fund is what we're calling it for short. Also, if you have a need yourself, if you need to ask for a grant, in the care button, there's a way to click for need help. And in that form, there's a way for you to apply for a financial grant. And we are prepared to give grants up to $500 to help bridge the gap. And please, we really want you to ask for the help if you need it. The other thing is that if you know someone who's perhaps not a regular worshiper at the cathedral, then we are open to regular worshipers of the cathedral referring others to take from this fund and to receive from this fund. And so I encourage you to do that. So it is called, again, and if you're not a person who's an online giver, that's okay. You can still write a check, mail it to the cathedral. Again, in the memo, if you want it to just go to the general fund, you can just put general fund or nothing. If you want it to go to the C3 fund, the Cathedral Community Care Fund, please write that in the memo, and we will make sure that it gets to the right place. Thank you for your generosity, and we want to do what we can to help those who are in need right now. I want to say a thank you to all those, speaking of caring for those in need, all those who helped us with our bridge church. Yesterday was our normal bridge church day, and we had multiple households providing bag lunches that we then took to Bridge Church and gave out food for those who are still homeless and living rough on the streets. And I know that that was a real blessing. So thank you to all those who made lunches, bag lunches for Bridge Church. And now, before we begin our service, I want to introduce a message from our bishop, Bishop Mark Lawrence.
I bring you greetings in the strong name of Jesus Christ on this most unusual Palm Sunday. I am Bishop Mark Lawrence, the Bishop of the Anglican Diocese of South Carolina. We, like many other Anglican churches around the world, have closed our buildings not out of fear, but out of the sake of our community, to assure them that we are praying for them and are seeking their best interest. Anglican churches from the United Kingdom to Australia, from North America to Kenya, from North Africa to the Indian Ocean, have in unity closed their churches for the sake of their community, but have continued to worship Jesus Christ in the various methods at our disposal. It is especially important on this Palm Sunday that we have the opportunity to begin to walk the way of the cross. It was the way that Jesus walked 2,000 years ago. It begins with his entrance on Palm Sunday into Jerusalem. It goes from there to Maundy Thursday and Good Friday, when he bore on the cross the sins of the world. It goes all the way to Easter, when he rose from the dead, that we might live with him and his Father forever. I invite you to make this journey. It is a unique opportunity. Christians have done this for 1,700 years, from the 4th century on. We have gathered to observe this Holy Week. If you've never had an opportunity to do so, today and this week is your time. It is the main road in the kingdom of God, this pathway to the cross. It is the path of self-denial and suffering, but in the midst of it, caring for others, reaching out in the ways we can to nurture, care, and guide them. It is the way that our Lord has blessed and invites you to walk with him. We invite you to join us in the various congregations all over the diocese who will be broadcasting online various services throughout this week. Join us. It is the pathway of hope. It is the pathway of trust. And it is the pathway of faith. We bring our lives under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. For the hands of Jesus that healed the lame, that touched the leper, is the hand that holds the future. And that hand yearns and desires to be over your life today and in the weeks to come. May God bless you as you join us on this wonderful week that we as Christians call Holy Week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
So we begin our journey into Holy Week. We make our way to Jerusalem. And as we do that, historically, we've always done a great procession with palm fronds being waved. And it's a joyful thing. And we want to just continue that. We're going to begin our service singing the great Palm Sunday hymn that we sing every Palm Sunday, All Glory, Laud, and Honor. I encourage you to sing this with gusto. If you are there in your home and want to march around your living room with palm fronds, we encourage you to do that. Make sure you take a picture of your green screen, and let's make this as festive as we can in our various homes. All glory, laud, and honor.
Keep
we begin our service of morning prayer. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor, saying together the confession. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And apart from your grace, there is no health in us. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare all those who confess their faults. Restore all those who are penitent, according to your promises, declared to all people in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may now live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you absolution and remission of all your sins, true repentance, amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of his Holy Spirit. Amen. O Lord, open our lips. O God, make speed to save us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. The mercy of the Lord is everlasting. And now, let us all say together the Venite. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and show ourselves glad in him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are all the depths of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Our first lesson for this morning is from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 52, beginning with the 13th verse. Feel free to open your own Bibles there at home if you'd like to Isaiah chapter 52, beginning at verse 13. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up, and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which has not been told them, they see, and that which they have not heard, they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of a dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm appointed for today is Psalm 118, beginning with the 19th verse. We will say this psalm responsively by whole verse. I invite you to say the even verses, and I will say the odd verses. Open unto me the gates of righteousness, that I may go into them and give thanks unto the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter into it. I will thank you, for you have heard me and have become my salvation. The same stone which the builders refused has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Help me now, O Lord. O Lord, send us now prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. God is the Lord who has shown us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords, even to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will thank you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is gracious. His mercy endures forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Our next lesson is taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21, beginning in verse 1. And I invite you to open up your Bibles there at home and follow along with us. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he entered into Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you please join me in prayer wherever you find yourself in this moment? Father, we give thanks to you that even though we are separated geographically in this difficult time, that through your work, through Jesus Christ, we are united, that we are together. And wherever we find ourselves, that we are your body, we are the church. And so we ask now that as we open up these scriptures to look, to learn, to place ourselves under them, we ask that you would illuminate our hearts by the power of your Spirit, that you would give us a glimpse of Jesus Christ, the crucified one, the risen one, the soon to come again one. And in seeing him, may we be transformed to become more like him from one degree of glory to the next. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I want you to take some time and envision moments of victory or of triumph. As I spent time this week thinking about moments of victory, pictures, images, videos, I found myself increasingly sad about the lack of sports that we have on right now. Because most of the time when I think about images of victory, I think about sports. I think about the success of winning a championship. And for those of you who are not into sports of any way, I just apologize and ask that you would bear with those of us who are mourning the loss of March Madness and the cutting down of nets that the winners do. I had images in my mind of piling on the pitcher's mound at the end of the World Series, of spraying champagne in the locker room after a win of a pennant. This past Thursday night, there was a replay of probably my favorite sporting event ever, and that was the 2006 National Championship game between Texas and USC. You can still watch it if you want to get on ESPN and see the greatest game of all time. And the image that sticks with me from that game is this image of one player, the MVP of the game, standing there and confetti just falling down upon him and him kind of shouting and the crowd is going wild. It's incredible, this incredible moment of triumph. And for those of you who are maybe not as big a sports fan as me, think about the images of VE Day that you see in the streets of New York, parades, celebrations. Think about when the sailor in New York in that famous image just grabs the woman and kisses her, which I guess in hindsight now is probably not quite okay, right? Think about the YouTube videos of people that get into their dream school, or think about proposals and celebrating that moment of victory. Think about when you get that promotion and the celebration that comes with that, those images of victory. Think about the images of victory that you've had, that you've experienced. And I would argue this morning that there's a very particular aesthetic. Victory has a particular look and feel and image that we have in mind. This morning, today, of course, is Palm Sunday. And we just read our gospel lesson fits this image well, right? This image of celebration, of triumph. We have Jesus who is cruising into Jerusalem on this donkey, which I just want to remind you that the donkey is not necessarily a humble beast at this point. It's basically like the limo of the ancient world, right? He doesn't come in on a war horse. He comes in on the limo. He's riding this animal, recognizing victory, recognizing that he is the king. And of course, they wave palm branches before him. These are historic signs of victory. After a great battle or war, people would be welcomed into the city and they would wave palm branches. Of course, they're chanting Hosanna in the highest, which just means save. Blessed is this one who's come, this messianic figure, the son of David. He's here. The reason they're celebrating is that their long-awaited Messiah has come. All of their hopes, all of their dreams have been placed into this very moment. And it feels like victory. It feels like triumph. It seems like a moment of victory. And yet we know, those of us who have read the end of the story, who've been through Holy Week before, we know that this moment is very different than the next moments. What begins in celebration and victory moves toward betrayal. It moves towards arrest. It moves towards the trial, the beating, the cross, and the death. Of course, it is a part. It is a celebration. But what I want to argue this morning is that what we see in this Old Testament lesson that we're going to look at in just a moment is that God's victory looks not at first like triumph. It looks like defeat. We're going to look at the victory of God. And so I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Isaiah 52. That's where we're going to spend all of our time this morning. And I just want to give you a little bit of context for Isaiah. Isaiah is a rich book. It's one of the most powerful in the Old Testament. There's some speculation that Isaiah, because of his access to kings and to royalty, was potentially part of the royal family himself. And the whole book is written at a time of great geopolitical upheaval. The Assyrian regime is kind of always threatening Israel, threatening Judah, threatening Egypt, and there's all of these massive kind of issues that are going on. And our particular text this morning is written before exile, but it's written in under the assumption of exile. It's written to those who will be in exile. Isaiah is forth-telling a message of hope to his people. One scholar has called Isaiah a microcosm of the entire Bible, because the first, essentially, half of it is focused on judgment. It's God coming to his people Israel and reminding them of the ways that they have failed to uphold the covenant. And yet it's also written in judgment of the nations. And then the last portion of the book, we get these kind of images of all things being renewed, of a new heaven and a new earth. Many of our Advent passages, for instance, come from Isaiah. In the middle portion, we get glimpses of how this is accomplished. How do we move from judgment to triumph? And that is where we find ourselves in Isaiah 52. There's a promised redemption at the end of the book, but here is how. Here's how the judgment moves towards redemption. And I'm going to argue this morning that Isaiah gives us five images in this text, from 52 to 53, five images of what God's victory looks like. So let's jump in. Verse 13. Isaiah says, "See, behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which has not been told them, they see, and that which they have not heard, they understand." The first image that we see here of what God's victory looks like in contrast with our understanding is that God's victory looks first and foremost like servanthood. When looking at the means and the mechanism by which we go from judgment to redemption, we hone in on this servant. And the first word there, my Bible says, "Behold," yours may say something like, "See," "look," "pay attention to," functions as a spotlight. Prior to this point, we've had hints. There's mentions of the servant in prior chapters. But here we begin to see him with a spotlight shined upon him in full light. This is the servant. And of course, the first verses are not surprising at all. "He shall be high. He shall be exalted. He shall be lifted up." That sounds right, right? When we think about victory, we think of high and exalted. It's worth noting that Isaiah uses that language of high and exalted a lot, but he's always speaking of God. God is the Holy One of Israel. He is the one who is high and exalted. And so there's something about this servant that is like God. But the next few verses, of course, are jarring. This servant who is high and exalted is also marred beyond human semblance. People are astonished at this contrast, and so too we are astonished of this. This is not an image of a hero, right? We have images of heroes. I just talked about them. But here we have a servant who is exalted and yet also marred. And yet somehow this servant is going to be before the great ones, before the kings. Kings will shut their mouths before him. Nations he will sprinkle. So somehow this exalted yet lowly servant is going to impact the great ones of the world. So that's the first thing. God's victory looks like servanthood, and particularly a servant. Continuing on, Verse 1 of 50, chapter 53. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? The arm of the Lord there is a reference to God's saving power. Think about Exodus and when God rescued his people from Egypt, from slavery in Egypt. It was with his arm of the Lord, his mighty arm, his outstretched arm. And so this is God's power to save. And again, this sounds right. When we call to mind the Exodus, this sounds like the kind of hero that we envision. The arm of the Lord is about to be revealed. We're about to see what this servant looks like, and yet it continues. This servant is easy to be overlooked. He's one who is brought up like a root out of dry ground. He has no form or majesty that we should look at him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. And then even more darkly, he was despised and rejected by others. He is a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and is one from whom others hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him of no account. And so again, somehow this servant is not just overlooked, although he is easy to overlook. He has no beauty that we should desire him or look towards him. But even more than that, he's despised, he's rejected. He's one who knows infirmity. He's acquainted with it. He knows it well. And again, this is shocking. This totally upends our understanding of what victory looks like. And that's the second point, that for Jesus, victory looks like suffering. This servant is one who suffers. But why does he suffer? Continuing on in verse 4, surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Why does this servant, one who confounds our images of victory, why is this servant one who experiences suffering and rejection? He experiences that because of us, for our sake, for God's people, for the nations, for those who have rejected God's covenant and God's call. He suffers for us. And so that is why God's victory looks like substitution. Substitution. We find that this servant is one who suffers in place of sinners. The language here calls to mind Leviticus 16, where we have this image of a scapegoat, where all the sins of the community of Israel are representatively placed upon this goat, and he's sent out into the wilderness. God's victory looks like substitution. I want you to note the contrast in these verses here of the one and the many, the he and the we, or the he and the us. He has taken upon himself all of these things, all of these transgressions, infirmities, diseases, wounds for us. I want to make note of the fact that when we see this work of the servant accomplished on our behalf, that it's not simply transgressions, nor is it infirmities or diseases. But in verse 5, it says, upon him the punishment that made us whole. That is peace. That is shalom. It's holistic. It is forgiveness of sins. We are sinners who have broken God's covenant and are in need of God's redemption and God's forgiveness. And this servant has offered us that, suffering in our place. Yet more than that, it's also about healing. It's about becoming whole. It's easy for us to pick and choose just one or the other, depending on our backgrounds, our histories, or the ways we've seen theology applied, right? To focus on the healing aspect or to focus on the forgiveness aspect. But here the image we see, the work of this servant, the work of God's victory is both. It is both forgiveness of sin and transgression, and it is healing and wholeness. God's victory looks like substitution on our behalf. Verse 7, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open up his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearer is silent, so he did not open up his mouth. in this portion, we see that God's victory looks like silence. We don't see a victory cry here. We don't hear a war chant. We hear silence. The image that she uses is like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, willingly offering up himself for the sake of others. He, the servant, is innocent, it says. He has done no wrong, and yet he keeps his mouth closed. 1 Peter certainly harkens back to that when he speaks of Jesus and commends this image to us, that though Jesus was reviled, he chose not to revile in return. Peter commends us to take that upon ourselves, to remain silent in the midst of suffering. God's victory looks like silence. The final point, let's look at verse 10. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him, the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish, he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressions. The final point is that God's victory is satisfying. It's worth it. Somehow for both the Lord, who has made a way for his people to return to him, and also for this servant, both of them find rich satisfaction in this work. Though it is painful and though it is humiliating, it is somehow worth the cost. Alex Motyer, an Old Testament scholar, says that we who wander as sheep are welcomed back as children. And that's the image that we see here again and again. That is, that by the work of the one, the many are welcomed back. That is the good news of the gospel, friends. That Christ Jesus, who is this suffering servant, has accomplished this work on our behalf. The victory of God looks at first like defeat. But in the end, it is more glorious. It is more triumphant than it was before. A.W. Tozer summarizes this whole concept, I think, really well when he says, "In reality, salvation was brought not by Jesus' fist, but by his nail-pierced hands. Not by muscle, but by love. Not by vengeance, but by forgiveness. Not by force, but by sacrifice. Jesus Christ, our Lord, surrendered in order that he might win. He destroyed his enemies by dying for them and conquered death by allowing death to conquer him." The victory of God is satisfying for the Lord, for his servant Jesus, and ultimately for us. But I recognize that wherever we find ourselves right now, that it may not feel that way. It may feel distant. And even the movement from Palm Sunday to Good Friday, that feels like such a drop-off, that feels like such a whiplash, can feel like what many of us are feeling right now. I know many of you are feeling like you have been on a roller coaster and have just gone over the edge, or maybe more acutely like a car crash. Who, of course, could have ever predicted 3 weeks ago that we would be here separated, isolated, not able to gather on this week of weeks? I know that many of you had plans, that you had dreams, that you had hopes. You were planning your vacation or your graduation, or you were planning to do this or that with your time. I spent the beginning of this year reading a book called Your Best Year Ever, and had so many plans, so many dreams, so many things that I was going to accomplish. It's quite sad, in fact, now that all of those seem to have been lost by the wayside. And yet, because we are a people whose God conquers through suffering, who triumphs through defeat, we know that he is the God who suffers with us. He's acquainted with our griefs. He knows our difficulty in this time, even in this time of coronavirus. And ultimately, he suffers for us. We know that this is the pattern, friends. We know that to win is done by losing. To triumph is in defeat. And so in many ways, this is our time. This is our time to shine. This is how the church has always flourished in the midst of difficulty. in the midst of persecution, in the midst of despair and distress, and yes, plagues. Because we know that our God is the one who conquers despite suffering or through suffering. This is how we win. And because we know the end, we can be people who suffer well. And so I invite you to, after you finish worshiping with your family, to just take a few minutes and just ask the question. If we know this, if we know that our God achieves victory through defeat, what does that mean for us? How can we be people who shine brightly in this dark time? Friends, when you think about victory, I want you to put aside those images of palms waving and of champagne being sprayed and confetti flying around. And instead, think about this servant, Jesus Christ, that we see here in Isaiah. The suffering servant, the slain lamb. This is what God's triumph looks like. And on this Palm Sunday, we experience a foretaste of the suffering triumph that we will see throughout this week. May we be people who are confident in hope because our God suffers with us and for us. Amen.
And now, as the people who have been those sheep that wander and yet have been welcomed as God's children through the suffering of his servant, our Savior Jesus Christ, let us stand and let us confess our faith in him, saying together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, as you're able, if you'd like to kneel or sit, let us pray together. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, show your mercy upon us and grant us your salvation. O Lord, guide those who govern us and lead us in the way of justice and truth. Clothe your ministers with righteousness and let your people sing with joy. O Lord, save your people and bless your inheritance. Give peace in our time, O Lord, and defend us by your mighty power. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. O Lord, save your people and bless your inheritance. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and take not your Holy Spirit from us. Almighty and everlasting God, in your tender love for us, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon himself our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering and come to share in his resurrection through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. O God, our King, by the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, on the first day of the week, you conquered sin, put death to flight, and gave us the hope of everlasting life. Redeem all our days by this victory. Forgive our sins. Banish our fears. Make us bold to praise you and to do your will. And steel us to wait for the consummation of your kingdom on the last great day through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh, and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, I know for all of us, the reality of the situation of being separated from one another means that we cannot take communion together. And especially on a day like Palm Sunday, in a week like Holy Week, where this is the week on the Thursday before Good Friday that the Lord instituted his supper, we miss it. But we're missing it together. There is a time of fasting that we're enduring. But we still can receive from the Lord. We receive through his word. We are nourished through that, and there will be a day when we will be back together and we will receive the sacrament of Holy Communion together. But in the time while we wait for that, let us pray this prayer. Let us pray it together. The words will appear for you on the screen. This is a prayer for spiritual communion. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people, and I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. And now let us stand and let us sing together this song of praise. My song is Love Unknown.
So divine, never was love, dear King, never.
And now, with grateful hearts unto the Lord, let's pray together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. We'll now sing together, Sing to Jesus. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Friends, we now make our transition from that triumphal entry, the great hosannas being shouted to the Son of David, and we make our way into the journey of the suffering servant, Holy Week. And tonight, at 7 o'clock, I invite you to come and join us again. And we will have a special offering of the reading of the Passion narrative, a Palm Sunday tradition. And we've done it in a particularly interesting way, a way very familiar to many of us during COVID-19. We're doing it through a Zoom call. So it's recorded. It's already been done. You don't have to jump on a Zoom call, but just come watch the video and participate in the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ this evening at 7 o'clock. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.